Well, good morning. Welcome to St. Andrews. My name is Jason. For those of you joining us online, we're glad you're with us. And if I haven't met you yet, I'm one of the pastors here and just really thrilled that you're here today on this St. Patrick's Day. You look great. How's your corned beef doing? Got it ready? You had your lucky charms this morning or whatever? Like, we're ready to go. I want to start off our time today with a little bit of a little game. So kind of like a word association. So I'm going to say a name, and I want you to say the first thing that comes into mind when you think about this name, okay? So first one, Kevin Durant. Basketball. Shohei Ohtani. John Rahm. Judas. Traitor. Anybody want to change their Shohei Ohtani descriptor? Anybody feeling that right now? It's not really fair. All of these folks, at one time or another, have been considered a traitor. I can talk about Benedict Arnold. Like, his name is synonymous with being a traitor, right? The biggest, even if you don't know anything about him, you know that name. What is it about people who turn their back on their own, the people they love or where they're from or the team that paid them millions of dollars to make them a star in the beginning, that causes us to just despise them? I mean, USA Today in December wrote these words about John Rahm. John Rahm is a hypocrite and a sellout, but he's getting paid, and that's clearly all he cares about. That's kind of harsh. I mean, it's not like he was selling secrets to the Russians, you know? But there was a guy named Robert Hansen that did that. Do you remember that name? He just died last year. Robert Hansen, the most despicable and destructive spy sellout for the United States that ever was. He was selling, through the FBI, selling secrets to the Soviet Union and then to Russia that followed. Everything from turning in, like, folks who were double agents, these Russian agents that were murdered because of that, to telling the Russians how we would react with a nuclear attack. Like, this is where the president would go, this is what would be our response. I mean, this guy was just despicable. There's something in the human heart that is just disgusted by a traitor, you know? So much so that I think it's kind of interesting. If you remember Dante's Inferno, anybody remember reading that book? Some of you in high school, have you read Inferno, Dante? No? Okay. Some schools, they do. Pacifica. Dante's Inferno, like in his levels of hell, as he's describing how we're punished and like the worst people, at the bottom are three folks whom he considered the worst traitors in the world. Judas, Brutus, and Cassius. And what's happening to them is they are being eaten without dying for days on end for eternity by a three-headed Satan just gnawing on them, because that's what we think about traitors. The vantage point that I'm going to give you today as we continue in this series, trying to get a picture of who Jesus really is, the vantage point is from a guy that could easily have been described like they described John Rahm. Sellout, hypocrite, only cares about money. His name is Matthew. And it makes me ask a question, because it's been said before, like, every man and woman has their price. That given the right circumstances, experience, opportunity, that every single one of us could be turned. Do you agree? Like, what's your price? I know, right, you wouldn't sell secrets to a communist country. But have you ever been in a conversation and you shared someone else's secret just so in that moment you could look powerful or important or be popular? See, it's so deep in us to turn, to betray, to have treachery, that even when George Washington found out about Benedict Arnold's plan and his treachery, he actually said, you know, we should be more surprised that there aren't more people who are caught doing this. Because humans want acceptance or value or worth or a bigger story so much, we're willing to do just about anything to get it. I'm going to show you through the eyes of Matthew how this man who was a traitor would see Jesus and what you and I can learn about it this week. It starts in Matthew chapter 9, and it begins in verse 9. It says this. As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. "Follow me," he told him, and Matthew got up and followed him. Pause right there. Many of you know something about tax collecting, and you know why this is kind of shocking to a Jewish reader, but let me just give you a little more info in case you're not there. We'll catch everybody up. In this time, the first century Judaism period, tax collecting was the most unpatriotic, treacherous, despicable, disgusting behavior that you could be a part of. The Roman Empire would conscript people from the Jews, their own people, to come in and to basically extort money from their brothers and sisters and family members and friends, their own, in order to finance the empire's oppression of the people. And they would always choose people from that same area to do it, which put them in an awful position. So in order to do this, there were a few things that you would have to believe. And I always think when we talk about like somebody who's a betrayer, you know, a traitor, it's easy to just say it's about money. I mean, maybe it's that simple. It's just greed. But if you were a tax collector, the cost was so high. Like, you were no longer able to go to the temple. You were usually considered dead by your family and rejected. You could not be a legal witness in court because there's no way you were ever going to tell the truth. You couldn't even give to charity. Like, the United Way wouldn't even take your money. They thought it was so bad. That's supposed to be funny. You were a total outcast if you chose this. In fact, the rabbis who were constantly teaching people how to live lives of holiness would say, but you can lie to a tax collector because they're dogs anyway. Feel free, go for it. So this is a guy named Matthew. Now, what causes you to do that? What is it besides maybe just money that would make you sit in that booth and sell out your own people? Tax collectors used things like extortion, threat of prison, torture, lying about people to their other family members. They knew how to make this work. And I think for anybody who would go that far, you had to already have felt that you were beyond reach. You were irredeemable. Maybe like the culture had already shut you out, or you had done something as a criminal so much that there was no coming back anyway, so you might as well just make some money. Matthew is sitting at this tax booth. Jesus walks past, and I love the language. It says he saw him. Now, this happened in a place called Capernaum where Jesus was doing a lot of miracles. So there's no doubt that Matthew had seen Jesus before. He's been healing people and feeding people and opening blind eyes. And in fact, just a few days before, he had healed that guy. Remember we talked about a few weeks ago, the one that the friends lowered him through the roof because he was lame, he couldn't walk? Jesus had just healed him. And then he's walking on through and he sees Matthew. And when he sees him, he doesn't just see him. He looks into him. In his moment of rebellion, betrayal, and Matthew is doing the work. Jesus sees him at his worst moment. Just like he's seen you and me at our worst moment. One of my favorite pastors, a lady I used to be on staff with named Quinn Lee, she has this phrase she says, I love it. She says, God always catches his fish before he cleans them. And I think anybody resemble that, right? He doesn't wait until we get everything all worked out and worked up and shiny and looking good. He goes at us in the middle of treachery, which is what he does with Matthew. And he says, follow me. And Matthew gets up from the table, the place of his wealth and power and identity and what had saved him from whatever caused him to go there in the first place. And he walks away from it and follows Jesus. It's a picture of something, and we talk about in Reformed theology, of this thing called irresistible grace. The Christ's call to everyone is open invitation. Come. Anybody who's tired, who's weary, who's burdened, who's guilty, who's sick, anybody who wants this invitation to life, come. But then there are other moments where he effectually calls you. Like he speaks directly to your heart, and folks, when he does that, you can't say no. The overwhelming understanding of his love and grace does in us exactly what happened to Matthew. You just get up and say yes. Some of you, you've experienced that. Others of you are here today because Jesus is after you. Not to get you, but to get you. Last night, our Saturday night service, lady came up after the service was over, and she said, you know, my friend invited me tonight. And I was like, that's great, because last week we talked about being Andrews, living into our name, right, inviting people. And she's like, now I understand why, because I feel like I'm too far gone. And I said, sister, your friend didn't know what I was going to be preaching about today. I didn't tell them that's why to invite you. God was after you. You're here because he wanted to meet you in this place because he saw you and he loved you. Isn't that cool? Some of us have lived that exact experience. So Jesus calls Matthew. Matthew gets up, and then in verse 10, we read this. Then while Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, so as soon as this happened, the next day maybe, the first thing Matthew does is to throw a party. And it says many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. So let me paint this picture, okay, get the image. First, Matthew understands something that one of these days I'm going to preach a sermon about called party theology. That we actually should throw more and better parties as Christians. We should be the best partiers of anyone. You understand what I mean, right? Because there's something about this celebration of the grace we've experienced. We should be extending that all the time. Matthew gets it. And so the guy who was beyond reach, untouchable, unlovable, completely unable to even to be in a place like this with a rabbi, he says, this is so good, I'm inviting all my friends. But guess who all his friends are? Other tax collectors, outcasts, and here's code for you. Anytime the Bible uses this word like tax collectors and sinners, the sinners part is usually code for people with sexual sin. Prostitutes, reckless people, the kind that you don't go to dinner with, at least in this time. Matthew just invites who he knows. And it makes me think some of you, like maybe there's a part of your life and a group that you came from, your people, that you might be able to reach back into, not because of your record that was so good when you were doing that, but because of your rescue, that Jesus pulled you out of that. And maybe you can come back and say, look, I just want to throw a party and let you get to know him. So get the scene, Matthew and all the worst people in society, and then Jesus and his disciples. And this is kind of interesting, because we already know some of the disciples that are there are some of the most patriotic people in the land. A guy named Simon, who is a zealot, and a guy named Judas, we'll talk about next week, who was also likely a zealot. These people loved their country and their people so much, they would go around killing Romans, doing anything to overthrow this oppression. And then over here is Matthew, the one who could care less about his people and sold it out to make some money. And Jesus puts them around the same charcuterie board and says, let's have a party. So you have to understand, this is striking. This is what helps you make sense of the next verse. It says, when the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? Now, this is a legitimate question. Imagine you were strolling through Westcliff this afternoon, this evening, and you look in the, you know, that kind of outdoor eating area at Olia that's right there? You kind of look through there and you saw me and John Huffman at a big table surrounded by all of the worst criminals in Orange County. The people who you know steal money, the people who run all of the disgusting parts of the underbelly of culture. And here we were yucking it up with a big group like that. You would ask the same question. Excuse me, what are you doing? The reason that this is such a big deal is because at this time, first century Judaism, what's called table fellowship was a really important thing. Whoever you invited to your table was more than just hospitality. It was that. But it was more. Your table and the people around it represented who you affirmed and accepted. It was almost like saying, Jesus, are you condoning this behavior? So you understand that the religious people, they should be bothered. But Jesus did something different. Every time he put people around the table for this meal, and you know this, because all in Jewish history and the ritual and custom, they love, God always built into it meals around tables. Think about all the feasts. Feast of Passover, Feast of Weeks, Feast of Booths. Jesus gets the Last Supper together. Like, there's always this moment where God wants to sit at a table with his people. Isn't it interesting? Do you know that the average person has 10,000 taste buds? I know this feels like a rabbit trail, right? 10,000 taste buds. Why did God make it that way? Like, he could have given you one. You know, and you'd be like your dog. Like, everything tastes the same every day. It's great. Love it. Just the same flavor. But God gave us this. He not only wants us to experience his provision, his supply of our need as a creature, he wants us to experience his prodigality, which is just a big word that means generousness, his flourishing, his abundance. So around this table, Jesus says, I'm going to call people that are going to give you a picture of the kingdom to come. You thought it looked like this, but it actually looks like this. The ones who know they need me, the ones who are dependent, who thought it was over, they had messed up too much. They're beyond redemption. I can't do enough to atone for it. And some of you know exactly what that feels like because you're doing it right now. You show up at church and you walk through this, and there's a part of you that just hopes God will forgive you one day for the things that you did, and you can't get over this low level of guilt. And he wants to say to you exactly what Jesus said, come sit at my table. Because he saw you in the middle of it, and he still wanted you. The religious people can't understand what's happening, because this shared meal was a picture of the kingdom of heaven and earth coming together on this St. Patrick's Day. I'll just kind of remind you of a good old Celtic way of viewing this. They would say that the table is where the veil between heaven and earth is really thin. In fact, I asked you last week to consider inviting somebody to church with you, but maybe before we invite someone to church or even to Jesus, we should invite them to dinner. It's so missional and so powerful, you have no idea what might happen. So, this shared meal becomes the place where Jesus wants to teach a lesson. Verse 12. On hearing this, hearing the religious people ask, why does your guy sit with the refuse? Jesus says, it's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. It's kind of funny. Some of you are physicians in the room. He's trying to correct them because it would be like saying, like, you know, if you were a doctor and you had the training and you had the experience, the expertise, the wisdom, and the prescription pad, but then every time a sick person got around, you're like, whoa, back up. I'm a doctor. Wouldn't that be ridiculous? You have what someone needs. Jesus is saying to the people who are religious, you're like a doctor who won't get around sick people. I came not for the healthy people. I came for the sick. And then he says these words, and this is what's just wrecked me this week, and so I'm going to spend the rest of our time on this verse. He says, but go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I haven't come to call the righteous, but sinners. Mercy, not sacrifice. When I used to read this, and you've probably heard this verse before, right? It reminds me of another one. Jesus is quoting from Hosea in this one, but there's another verse that sometimes especially we quote with our kids. Obedience is better than sacrifice, right? Like, rather than come and make a good apology, just stop screwing up. And sometimes I read this and I thought that's what Jesus is talking about, but that's not what he means. Sacrifice is kind of emblematic, or it's a code for religion. And so he's saying two things. On the one hand, he's saying to his people, I desire you to show mercy, not religion. Let me put it to you like this. Imagine that you got real excited about what St. Andrew's is doing, like in our missional ways. We're partnering with folks like Olive Crest to help with vulnerable children and families who are in distress. And you like signed up to go to be one of those, or at the packing party last week, which thank you all, amazing. What if you went to that and like you're doing your duty, you're making the sacrifice, and the whole time you were there, you just complained and gossiped and talked about how they're doing it wrong and why didn't they set it up this way, and like you just totally missed it. Sacrifice, not mercy. Back before I became a pastor in my old job, I was going to this church, and it was great. And one time we had this weekend where we're going to all serve together, right? All 6,000 people go serve the city. And so there were lots of ways to do it. You could go to the food pantry, and you could go visit people in assisted living, and you could work at the elementary school. And a few of us decided to go to this area of town, and there was a group of folks that lived in a place that had been, like, gentrified, and so they were stuck in the middle. And it was called Pegram Street in Charlotte. And there was a guy named Ron that was there. Ron had lost his legs because of kidney disease, and he was in serious poverty, and he was old, and his house had just fallen into just terrible disrepair. So there's weeds and vines and stuff all over it. His air conditioner stopped working, and it gets hot in Charlotte in the summer. I mean, like, hot. And so a few of us go, and we're going to serve there. I mean, this is good stuff, right? This is being Jesus, hands and feet. Let's go. And we're clearing stuff, and this was so cool. You're going to be the first to hear some of this. Well, you in the last service, and then anybody who watches on the internet ever. But I got a machete, and I'm like living my best life, like cutting down branches, and I'm grabbing vines and pulling it off the house, and I'm covered in leaves and this stuff. And one of my buddies goes, "Hey, you know that's poison ivy, right?" And I was like, "Well, of course." And sure enough, I got lit up. Like, I couldn't go to work for 3 days. I'm covered. I had to take steroids. I had to put that pink lotion stuff all over me. Like, I'm swollen. I look like Hitch for a little bit, right? And I was at home, and I kid you not, I didn't say this to many people, thankfully, but I was so angry at God. I'm out here doing your work, serving this guy, Ron. And you have the audacity to let me get covered in poison ivy? Didn't you see what I was doing? Like, it's kind of embarrassing to tell you, truthfully. But, like, that was sacrifice, no mercy. Mercy is, in that passage in 1 Corinthians 13, some of you got cross-stitched for your wedding that's somewhere. You know, love is patient, kind, blah, blah, blah. It says, if I have faith to move mountains but don't have love, I am nothing. That was me that day. All kinds of service, no mercy. Jesus says, he looks at those people that are so upset at the group he's gathered around the table, and he says, I desire mercy, not sacrifice. It reminds you of the story of the Good Samaritan, remember? Where the guy's laying on the ground, he's sick and bleeding and dying probably, and then two people go past. You remember who the first two are? A priest and a Levite. A pastor and a worship leader. Jason and Brandon walking by like, that's tough. And just keep going. Now, why do they do that? We read it and we think like, oh, it's because they're busy or, No, you know why? Why the two religious leaders didn't? Because they didn't want to become religiously, ceremonially unclean. They were following the rules of religion. If you touch a body that might be dead, you're unclean. I can't go do my work. If I touch a body that's bleeding, I'm unclean. I can't go make a sacrifice. They were seeing sacrifice with no mercy. So Jesus says, that's not what I want. I didn't make you for that. This is not about religion. It's about mercy. Here's what mercy does. Mercy sees pain. Mercy is moved with compassion. Mercy springs into action, even to an enemy. Unpatriotic Matthew, sitting at the tax collector booth. Couldn't be a worse enemy of the state. And Jesus says, that one's mine. And he said the same thing to you. The same thing to me. Some of you, he's saying it to you right now. He desires mercy, not sacrifice. But I think as I've reflected on this week, it's not just that he desired for his people to have mercy. He actually was saying, I desire to give him mercy. And I will do it by becoming the sacrifice. I will fulfill the religion so that I can give him what he does not deserve. Isn't that cool? That's what Jesus, when he sees you in the middle of your worst moment, that's what he wants, not just for you, but to give you. It's like a miracle. I mean, really, it is. In fact, Tim Keller says that if grace is the gospel, you know, if grace alone is the gospel, then every conversion is a miracle. And if you're a believer, a follower of Christ, you're a miracle today. It's why Matthew places this story right after that miracle of the lame guy coming through the roof. Because he wants to say when he writes this, you saw this miracle making a guy who couldn't move his legs stand up and walk. You ought to see what he did with the traitor. That's a miracle. Amazing. Matthew saw that Jesus' priority was his mission, not religion. And so, Matthew makes this move. He moves from being a sellout that we all hate to sold out that everybody hated. Because now he went from being the one who was looked down upon because of his profession to the one who's reviled because he's following this Jesus cat. And Matthew is so willing to chase meaning, value, worth, righteousness, that he's willing to do whatever it takes to get it. The rest of Matthew's life, he becomes, like many of the disciples, an evangelist. He goes around the world. He ends up in Ethiopia and where he's murdered for his faith. And Matthew just couldn't stop telling people what a miracle it was that one day Jesus saw. It's funny, you know, his book, the Gospel of Matthew, it's the first one in the New Testament, right? When you flip it open, you got all the Old Testament, the prophets, all that, and then you get Matthew. It's not because Matthew wrote his first. It's because the guy who sold out all of the Jews, his people and his religion, he actually wrote a version, a vantage point of Jesus that was so thoroughly Jewish. Because Matthew turned around and he said, if he can rescue me, I got to make sure he'll go get them. So he uses 50 different quotations of the Old Testament. He tries his best to write to the people that he once turned his back on and say, this is the Messiah you were looking for. He's the promised one. It's the king. The kingdom has come. So beautiful that he does that. And that same offer, that same invitation is made to us. The question that I think we have to answer, though, and I'll end with this, is when's the last time that you recognized you needed mercy? Like, maybe it was, I don't know, an hour and a half ago, trying to get ready to get here. But maybe it's been a while since you've remembered that you were that guy once, you were that girl once, that the past and the record, the resume, the failure, the sin, the addiction, the brokenness, the walking out on your spouse, the betrayal, the stealing, the lying, the cheating, maybe it's been a while since you've remembered that that was you and Jesus looked at you and he saw you. See, I think it's really easy for us, St. Andrews, to get stuck on the sacrifice part and miss the mercy. Because I think we're pretty good. I think we know how to do church pretty good. I think we know how to do religion pretty good. I know that's not grammatically correct. I didn't go to Pacifica, clearly. I think it's easy for us to be just like those people looking through the window and seeing Jesus gathered with all of the folks that thought they were too far gone and go, what are you doing? So my call for us for the next 2 weeks is maybe get in touch with the mercy that we got. Not so that we can walk around feeling depressed and guilty. And so, I don't mean that. I mean, maybe just remind yourself of it, because once you do, the first reaction that you'll have when you really let your brokenness and failure wash over you, and then the second, like God's mercy on you, when you let that happen, my guess is you're going to want to throw a party. And I think we're just the people to do it. So can I pray for you, that, and pray for me, that we might, like Matthew, recognize just what a miracle the mercy is, and then live out of that. Father, thank you so much that though you instituted religion to try to show us just how far the gap was, the sacrifices, the offerings, the death that was necessary to cover our sin. Though you instituted all of that, you did it to point us to the final sacrifice. And you wouldn't send somebody else to do your work. You came yourself. Jesus, when you looked in the eyes of people, and as I try to imagine your face, I just don't think that you said it with harshness of tone. I think when you said, "I desire mercy," I think there was this love that flowed out of you. So many of us have experienced that. So many more of us need to. So my prayer is that for my friends here, whatever their age, whatever their background, whatever's made them think that they're too far, God, that you would see them. That you'd call them, and it would be that effectual call. And truthfully, Jesus, for all of us, There's not words. I mean, we tried. We sang that you are worthy of it all. We sang about your reckless love, but it just doesn't feel like it's enough. And so instead of trying to use fancier words, would you just now accept our thank you?